Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies this morning. Our first item of business in public for today is a decision on taking business in private and specifically whether consideration of the committee's work programme should be taken in private today and future meetings. Are we all agreed? Thank you. So our next agenda item is an evidence session as part of our annual pre-budget scrutiny. This year, our focus is on how the Scottish Government's approach to fair and efficient funding can support the ongoing effectiveness of the third sector. So I welcome our first panel of witnesses who are joining us online. So we have Ran Mujumdar, Trustee, Edinburgh Voluntary Organisations Council, and we have Lynn Tulloch, Executive Officer and Company Secretary for Voluntary Action Shetland. So thank you for accepting our invitations. Before we move on to our questions, just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So if you could please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. And please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. You can also indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you actually wish to come in on a question. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So I'm going to move on to our first line of questioning. I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Thank you, Vina, and good morning, panel. Thank you for making time today to take our questions. I wonder if I can start off in regard to multi-year funding, and perhaps you could explain what is the benefit for organisations for having multi-year funding, and what are some of the obstacles at the moment for getting that. Maybe start with Lynn, if that's OK, and then move on.
Thank you very much for offering me the opportunity to come this morning to give evidence. I think multi-year funding is really quite paramount in offering UK sustainability and continuity of service. It allows that job security for third sector staffing to be able to directly deliver what's being commissioned kind of on the ground. If we have short-term funding where you might have 12 monthly cycles, you're really grappling with challenges year on year, and then staff are having to look at utilising some of their time within that year to be sourcing and trying to find funding to continue to sustain projects. There's also issues about you can being able to provide ongoing service provision within the community. So if you have service users that's accessing your service, there's that whole challenges year on year about whether there's going to be that kind of continuity of service. So really, multi-year funding, it's really, I suppose, paramount in being able to provide qualitative, sustainable services in the community and offer that element of job security for the staff that's delivering that.
Thank you. I don't know if you want to say anything, Ram.
Yes, sorry. I completely agree with what Lynn said, but I just wanted to add two things, one on the support side and one on the delivery side. The support side for people, you know, and if the Scottish Government and the UK Government policies about prevention, intervention and early intervention as a strategy in health and social care, we really need to make sure that there is continuous funding for projects to go beyond just providing a service, but to create relationships in the community. And if that's what we are gearing towards, then continuous funding does two things to organisations and the community. One provides a framework for workforce planning and workforce development, which is a very big issue in third sector everywhere, I'd assume, definitely in Edinburgh. The other part is co-production and collaboration. You know, there are many questions I read in the paper, you know, about the funding issues. And I think, in my opinion, and Evok's opinion, funding is not just about the cash or the money bit, but the resources, the planning which goes into it, the governance and the infrastructure. That can only be developed with multiple year funding and a continuity of the process and the people involved.
Thank you. I just wonder briefly, is there a greater impact on smaller charities in regard to not having multi-year funding? And maybe from your perspective, Lynn, from a rural perspective, again, is there a greater impact if you can't plan ahead in regard to that? So I maybe start with Lam this time and then go to you, Lynn, if that's okay.
I would say from Edinburgh perspective and Edinburgh Lothians, very definitely the small and the local organisations get more affected if there's no multiple year funding. It's just because the bottom lines and if you look at the kind of like organisation structure and operations, it's very threadbare. People, those small organisations definitely don't have the reserves to continue if funding stops or if a kind of like project comes to its conclusion. The other part of the smaller and local organizations is they are very community-based, like anchor organizations, and they pursue projects and services which may not be always funded in that way in contractually. So sometimes if there's no multiple-layer funding, some services which have layered services around it has a multiple ripple effect. So it definitely affects the local organizations more, in my opinion.
Yes, I would like to just really reiterate the points that Ran said, and certainly some small local grassroots organisations, they've got very, very tight margins, and some are very much voluntary-led with maybe very small staff and support, or maybe sometimes none at all. So that, again, that kind of dedication and commitment of having to, if you didn't have multi-year funding in place, having to be utilising time and resources to try and source and find funding to maybe sustain a very grass-rooted service or project within the community.
Thank you. Thank you, Gwina.
It's lovely. Thank you. I'm now going to invite Bob Doddison. Thanks.
Thanks, Gwina. Thank you both for witnesses for supporting our budget scrutiny this morning. The Committee heard a lot about the need for greater flexibility in funding. So yes, of course, organisers would like more money, but we know the climate we're in. But even without that, there's greater flexibilities would help voluntary organisations. We've heard about more money for core costs. We've heard about a small percentage of grants given could be put to reserves for future resilience. We've heard about unrestricted funds. We've heard about more general flexibilities and how money can be spent to meet outcomes. So we've heard about all those things. So any reflections that either witnesses have on those things or other potential flexibilities would be very welcome, including any benefits or potential drawbacks. So we'll maybe start with Lynn.
I would really welcome that flexibility to utilise funding kind of really where it's needed. When you have something that's really, really rigid, it can get really, really difficult in delivery when things change. And certainly, I think core funding is becoming more challenging to find and source. There's a lot, there's funding out there for project work, but it's in essence, sometimes when you don't have the core funding in place, there becomes that difficulty then of actually being able to deliver the project work. So you're almost slightly, I'm not saying chicken and egg, but it's just becoming more challenging where you're finding if your core is depleting or is becoming more challenging, where can you find the ability then to deliver project stuff in that essence? So I think the opportunity to be able to utilise funding kind of where it's needed. And certainly with reserves, UK, where charities are trying their best to be able to do some self-generated income through fundraising, through UK finding ways to have unrestricted source and funding for themselves, even that's a challenging situation as well. So it's, and I know certainly charities have to utilise sometimes the reserves to be able to maybe top up UK where project funding or core funding has not been able to provide 100% cost. So So, yeah, I would definitely welcome that opportunity for that flexible funding arrangement going forward to help charities and groups.
OK, thanks, Lynn. Ryan?
So, I completely agree with what you just said, and also what Lynn sort of like, you know, detailed. And a couple of my succinct points here is, if you look at, if you don't have the flexibility of funding, and again, I would like to extend the concept of funding to not just the income or the grants coming in. You know, it's about resources. And if we don't have the core functions in organizations, the collaboration with other partners or statutory sectors, offices, you know, which can create some stability for the organization and the services and the people, will dwindle. And if we don't have core, like Lynn said, we will not be able to deliver projects through smaller organizations. The other part is, and I know it sounds a bit counterintuitive, flexibility can sometimes be about innovative services, you know, giving the community a dynamic and organic kind of projects at the grassroots level, but also the old school stuff about governance and infrastructure. And this is not just about organizations, it's about, you know, the link between statutory sector and third sector, you know, and some of the governance and infrastructure that we can give to senior managers and CEOs of grassroots organizations is very important. And that's where some of the flexibility may not require additional amount of funding, but just a different way of looking at like interface organizations like ourselves and, you know, bodies like the Edinburgh Health and Social Care Partnership or Health and Social Partnership across Scotland, working together to provide that governance and infrastructure for smaller organizations as and when they need.
That's helpful, Ryan. And Ryan, let me stick with you for my follow-up question. I'll come to Lynn in a moment. Of course, one of the ways to build in the flexibilities that the third sector would require would be to have a close working relationship as funds are developed, almost like co-produced funding mechanisms that might be fit for purpose and build trust between the funder and the third sector. Ryan, are you aware of any examples of that? Is that something you'd like to see rolled out? And any general comments you want to make on that idea?
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, and this is one of the things which, like, EVOC themselves are going through a lot of transition just now this year, you know, and one of the things that we're trying to discuss with our IJB, Edinburgh IJB, is this kind of a model where, I mean, it's not just about procurement and allocations, you know, it's about the communication and understanding of both systems, you know, and that communication doesn't need to involve time from, you know, like a lot of time from organizations, because, you know, the way sometimes co-productions work is various meetings, various fora getting involved, and, you know, CEOs or senior managers of small organizations don't have time to go to all this. And so if the interface organizations and the IJBs or the offices create a platform of a consortium model where, you know, the representatives of member organizations and different fora come and form advisory groups, this bit will be much more streamlined. As of now, I can give an example of Lambeth in London. You know, the Lambeth Borough did a co-produce model, actually of procurement. As far as I'm aware from the data, it's still work in progress, and it's the same as Portsmouth. Now, these are innovative things, but I mean, what we need to make sure is we need to give these models time to develop. Sometimes, you know, we create these consortiums or these kind of models or allocation or alliance models, and then after 2 years, it just goes. The time is important, in my opinion.
OK, that's helpful, Ryan. And finally, Lynn, do you have any comments on this line of questioning?
Certainly, having that co-production would be really, really helpful, because I think it's back to that lived experience. And you came with charities living and breathing the challenges of having a patchwork of funding in order to manage their service. I think it's just about being able to listen and it's about developing that trust and coming together and being able to sort of share experiences at how, and it just maybe makes for a better way of working and how funding is allocated and how funding can be utilised in the best way possible. I think that would be the only other point to add.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCall. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. And good morning. Again, thank you very much for coming in and answering the questions. I'm going to follow on pretty much from the two groups that have just spoken, because we've looked at multi-year funding and flexible funding. And what we have been asked to look at is an inflationary bump within funding processes. But of course, you've got multi-year and you've got flexible funding. But both will all have to start from an accepted understanding that there's going to be fixed costs. And if we look at multi-year funding, those fixed costs are going to be fixed at the beginning, and et cetera. So I really just want to get some input from both of you. How can we do this? How can we take the models, both multi-year and flexible, and look at actually putting an inflationary bump on that? Because there's going to be unforeseen costs, but equally there has to be a starting point, and those starting points will come from a fixed cost. So, Ran, if I could start with you first to give you a bit of a move around, and then, Lynn, if you could give me your input on that. But how do you think we can change the models to do that?
It's a very, very crucial question. And I think, personally, flexibility, multi-year funding, and then if you're adding the inflationary, you know, bits to it, Rose, my suggestion or evokes thinking just at this time on the Edinburgh kind of scenario is we need to go into like more kind of collaborative approach in terms of the organizations providing support. Because, you know, as you say, and we all know this, and this is what we have to accept, that funding is limited. And it's going to be more limited in the future, perhaps, you know, or not having the capacity to increase as what we would ideally want. So within that, if we have, like, let's say, you know, there's this model of alliance alliance funding, there's a model of co-production, there's a model of, you know, preferred providers. I think somewhere in between, what we need to find is a way that sector-wise, for example, in Edinburgh, the children and families and the adults work get different kind of recruitment models or different kinds of, you know, fundings from the Scottish government, which comes to the local authorities and gets dispersed in a different way. A little bit more unified structure where the third sector fora and the members form a consortium themselves, being governed by officers or being in, and officers being included in it to give that kind of like multi-party kind of feeling there and understanding both systems is something which I would say would help towards this, towards an answer to this question. Because as of now, what happens is even though some bodies are like that, you know, some funding bodies are great, you know, in that sense, but there's disparity between sectors. And even like within health and social care, let's say, you know, some fund like adult care and mental health gets funded differently. I think that unified structure or moving towards a unified structure will give some, I would say, underspend in some budgets to take care of that inflationary costs. But that's only in Edinburgh context, Ros. I don't know whether that will apply to everywhere, you know.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Ran. Lynn, obviously you're coming from a different area. Could you give me your opinion on that?
I think in that set of circumstances, it's just really, really challenging. I mean, I think not having inflationary rates year on year in potentially kind of funding coming forward, that then it's a loss in real terms going forward, because as we all know, there's potentially salary uplifts and there's increased costs and things. And in some ways, I'm not really sure how we can actually change that. I don't know, but I know all I know from our sector is it's a very real challenge when on an annual basis we're seeing other sectors where you kind there's potential salary uplifts, and it's a real challenge for us to be able to sustain that or even offer that to worse staff going forward if our budgets sit at standstill. And yes, multi-year would be a really, really great thing to see coming forward. Yes, flexibility in that and inflationary rates would also be fabulous for us to have as well. But the challenge is where do we get to a point where that can happen?
Okay, I'm going to put you on the spot here, Lynn. My apologies for doing this, but if we're looking at multi-year funding and we're looking at flexible funding and we're looking at inflationary and we can't do them all, what would be the one that you would want to put to the side? sorry, I know it's a horrible question, but it's, you know, could it be that inflation just the restrictions, there has to be fixed costs, there has to be an understanding at the beginning that that's going to be there. Could inflation be the one that's just not going to get us over the line? Is that fair?
I think if you're having to really look at choosing two out of the three, I suppose the multi-year funding offers that ability for state sustainability for staff and for ourselves in the delivery. And the ability for us to allow to move the budget where we need it the most, that would definitely. I certainly wouldn't want to say no to the inflationary, but if there had to be that tough decision.
No, I totally get that. It was a horrible question, Lynn. I apologise. Ran, I'm going to just ask very briefly for your opinion on that. The same question. It's a horrible one, I know. But if we can't do all three...
No, I completely understand, Roz, you know, and that's the whole point. And we have to be understanding of that. And I agree with Lynn. It's the first two that I would go for, you know, flexibility and the, well, multi-year funding first and then flexibility around that, you know.
There you go. You're not on your own, Lynn. Thank you very much indeed, everyone.
Okay. Thanks very much, Roz. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm going to sort of stay on remuneration, but can you talk us through the challenges that you and your partners are currently experiencing in terms of paying the real living wage, and what more you think can be done by funders to support organisations to meet their commitment? I'll pop it to you, Lynn, first, if that's okay.
I mean, yes, the real living wage is certainly something that I am aware particularly through the mental health and wellbeing fund that we were distributing. That was a key element that had to be considered. And I suppose, in essence, we had community groups who were able to apply for that, who were going to be able to look at paying that. But maybe we had some conversations with community groups who just weren't in that position to be able to do that. So I think, again, it's kind of back to... ensuring that if funders are going to have that as a condition and as a requirement, it's actually being able to provide the funding to enable that to happen. And it's again a tricky one because funding is becoming more and more challenging going forward. But of course, we want to be able to be, or community groups and organisations, we want to be able to be paying a suitable wage that can support with kind of cost of living, and because we're very aware that staffing is impacted by this as well as we're service users. So there's something for me, and if that's something that's really going to be coming forward and more funders are going to have that as a key condition, there needs to be that recognition and that backing within the budget to be provided to those groups to enable that to happen. It's a bit long-winded.
Is that something you experience quite a lot, that expectation for kind of you guys to pay the real wage?
Well, I think we've had that experience from within the Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund, but I'm not as aware with other independent funders, but I just wonder if it may be one of those things that may come to fruition about enabling that to happen. So, we're just conscious maybe of the potential of that to be driving forward.
Thanks for that, Lynn. Ran, do you want to kind of say anything on that?
What Lynn says is absolutely correct. You know, I mean, ideally the budget should allow for that if that's what's on the specs for the budget, you know, and that's where I think the catch-22 is, that some local organizations or small community grassroots organizations will not be able to deliver that, you know, within the boundaries of that, of the specs. And in my opinion, or in our experience in dealing with this in Edinburgh context is, that's why, you know, I talked about that consortium and collaborative approach, you know, is perhaps, again, another route we can think of to alleviate this, that, you know, there's a lead provider, you know, who meets the specs and then, you know, kind of like, but still the grassroots organizations can be a part of that conversation, even though ideally, from the people side of things, that should not be the case, you know, but it's the question of where we balance this reality of funding being, you know, tight and as it is. The other part, and this is something which we are discussing with Edinburgh IJB sounds very controversial in a way, but even like it's sort of what Lynn touched upon. Different sectors, you know, have kind of different kind of almost grades of funding and what they're requiring in terms of salaries and wages and whatever, you know, which are fitted into the budget. For example, here in housing homelessness and the health and social care budgets, it's slightly different. And one of the, and the why I say controversial is perhaps unity is needed or equity is needed, you know, at least in the statute sector funding for those. The grants and the other sectors, we can't really control that, but at least the statute sector funding coming through from Scottish Government and local authorities can have a bit more unity around the specs of that. Perhaps that would help.
Thanks, Anne. That's helpful.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Katie Clark in. Thank you.
Good morning, and I'm going to ask about funding applications. How do you think funders could work with third sector organisations, especially smaller organisations, to create more proportionate reporting and application processes? And if I maybe ask Ran first.
Sure. I think this is perhaps a little bit more in the interface kind of organisation kind of reach here. And this is something which I think in, at least with in the Edinburgh context, we have been trying to develop for the last 2-3 years, that because the governance and infrastructure of smaller organizations are limited with the capacity to do some of these very complex funding applications or big applications, or, you know, for example, I can give you a simple kind of like comparison. In 2017, the PSPs under the mental health budget here in Edinburgh moved on to true co-production into a Thrive kind of model. But what happened, unfortunately, was a lot of the smaller organizations who were in the PSP couldn't, perhaps for structural reasons or the specs in the commissioning process, weren't able to be a part of that commissioning. This is where interface organizations, statute sector, or, you know, partners can provide that governance and infrastructure to the smaller organizations if we can get those funding applications a little bit more unified across the city. That's my only answer to that, really.
Thank
our
you.
Experience.
Thank you very much. Lynn, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, I mean, I think from even I've had lots of experience in my previous post about searching and sourcing funding to continue direct delivery services. And I think the key thing, especially when you're thinking about smaller community organisations, maybe voluntary-led groups, it's about keeping the process really straightforward, keeping it easy, not making it complex. And I think that again, as Ran was saying, having a kind of a more ability to be unified. I suppose a personal example is where I had a project that had a staff member allocated to that piece of work, and it was 4 different pots of funding that we were using to support that project. And it was slightly different application forms and slightly different monitoring. So we were kind of collecting different things for in slightly different ways to be able to report back on the same project, but just reporting back in slightly different ways. So it's about and I know organisations and charities will have that experience of keeping things going with multiple streams of funding, having to collect information and activity and reporting it maybe slightly differently, but kind of similar. So if there's a way that can keep that process straightforward, easy, and being kind of more unified in, I suppose, collecting the outcomes and the stats and the numbers and things, that would be really helpful, because that then, I suppose, in essence, allows more time for that service delivery process.
So you think more uniform processes would help. Do you think that third sector interfaces, TSIs, play a role in advocating and supporting the implementation of maybe more streamlined and uniform processes? Lynn?
I think certainly when we're hearing on the ground about just groups can working with a range of funders to sustain and keep their project going, certainly TSIs can hear the evidence on the ground and help to champion and maybe support that ability for that going forward.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Thank you again. I wonder if I can pick up an issue that I know Scottish Government are consulting on at the moment in regard to disclosure fees. At the moment, you'll be aware the Government pay for those in regard to third sector organisations, but they're consulting whether that should revert back to either the applicant or the charity. I wonder, if that did happen, what effect do you think it would have on volunteering in the area that you work in? And perhaps start with you, Lynn.
This will be the consultation about potentially volunteers having to pay for the PVG. Yeah. We had quite a lot of discussion that were within UK various teams here in Shetland about that. And I think the key thing would be that a lot of the charities would look to absorb that cost rather than potentially a volunteer taking that on, because in essence, what we really want is to make sure that volunteers come forward, and we want to make sure that their expenses and everything is kind of covered suitably by the charity. And one of the things would be looking at charities inevitably kind of paying for that on behalf of the volunteer. Not every charity, but I mean, it'll be each of their own discretion, but there was some notion that that would be a cost that they would look to pick up so that it would not deter volunteers coming forward to volunteer.
Thank you. Ram, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
I know I completely agree with Lynn on that bit, that it should not, the owner should not be on the volunteers, and you know, generally the charity will be should and will be able to pick that up. I mean, from my day job as chief officer and other senior leadership positions across organizations I've worked in, and that's what we generally do, you know.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can ask, in regard to how do delays in funding decisions and payments, either by Scottish Government or by local councils, affect the ability of voluntary organisations to retain staff and also maintain services? So again, maybe start with you, Lynn, and then come on to you, Ran.
That is a challenge. Certainly, where you've got groups that are working with really, really tight margins and didn't have the reserves and the backup to be able to tick that, look, well, okay, that bridging gap, you can until funding comes, and not every charity has that ability to kind of sustain UK payments and costs of staffing for a number of months until the payment comes. Sometimes staff, because of the delays in the funding, so we didn't have the sufficient resources to be able to pay that staff member, the staff ultimately leave and go on to other posts. And that's really, really difficult, because certainly in the third sector, we didn't have that backfill function. We can maybe look at the current staff to see what maybe can cover, but not necessarily have somebody to be able to come on the back of somebody leaving to do any backfill. But the delays are really, really significant. And delays in announcements as well is a real challenge as well for charities going forward, because it nearly pauses all the planning and the what are we going to do and the loss of staff ultimately as a result of that.
Thank you.
Jeremy, just to answer the question, it, very briefly, like what Lynn said, it is sometimes very, very difficult, especially for small charities, to sort of like, you know, take that into account, because their budgets and their resources are too tight to get that in. But one of the things that we have seen in Edinburgh, in certain groups of third sector organizations, in certain kind of like, you know, work streams, is what they try to do is negotiate with the funder about pooling resources, if that makes sense. So like, you know, if let's say £100 is given for the project, they try to like, you know, pool together with other organizations having similar kind of fundings to create or give that kind of bank or pool of resources for each other to help out in those kind of delayed situations. But that's difficult to administer and difficult to like, you know, coordinate, you know, other than trust between the organisations, if that makes sense.
Thank you. Thank you, Mina.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Paul O'Kane in. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I suppose I'm going to try and pull on some of the discussions we've already had and think a bit about, I suppose, parity of esteem and how the sector feels in terms of budget allocations and those negotiations, if you like. So the first thing I'm particularly interested in is what kind of mechanisms could we introduce to provide third sector organisations with more kind of stability? And we've already touched on this, I think, in terms of three-year funding and in terms of knowing what's coming. But I think particularly in the context of demand upon your services and demand upon the services for other partners in the public sector, I mean, what sort of mechanisms would you like to see introduced in line with those fair funding principles?
Who are you asking that question?
Sorry, Lynn, I don't know if you want to maybe speak about that first.
I'm wondering something. Is it a bit about, I suppose, the information that we report regarding our TSI activity, that you would like maybe more from us about the challenges and demands, or is it more...
I think it's a bit about the interaction with the public sector and service provision, so kind of looking at those sorts of where you have service level agreements that you have to report on, what would make that process easier, essentially?
I suppose with service level, I mean, certainly there's a range of charities within Shetland that have service level agreements with the local authority where work is being commissioned out. And I suppose it's just looking at where, because I'm trying to think about the right way to put this. What we're seeing within Shetland as well is that where we have service level agreements coming into the charity sector, we also see waiting lists within the charity sector. So we have challenges, I suppose, their high demands, what's going on for them. And then also we're seeing, I suppose, waiting lists within our local charities about sort of service demand. So it's, yeah, I suppose it's trying to look at, is it about looking at that information together and looking at, you can, where is the priority of need and where is the challenges locally and what are the areas that's being exhausted? Is that I'm answering the question.
Yeah, do you feel at the moment that in terms of funders, whether that be Scottish Government funding or coming through the local authority, that there is that, I suppose, management of the pressures that are there in terms of need? So you talked about waiting lists, and I would assume that would be for, you know, voluntary sector services, particularly in terms of care and support and those sorts of things. Do you feel that that's factored into sort of your budget conversations?
I think it's highlighted. I mean, certainly in the report and when it's going back to service level agreements, it would definitely need to be shown where charities are actually doing the work and also where there maybe should be some reporting about UK demand and where unmet need is being identified as well. Because ultimately, and I suppose that's something where the charity sector can showcase where UK, this is what we are being able to deliver and this is where our unmet need is. And maybe if that is recorded well, then maybe that can show evidence for more investment in that area or increased commissioning.
And do you think there are sufficient structures at the moment to be able to have those sorts of conversations, or do you think we need to do more at looking at how that is all communicated?
I think having those open conversations, I think, would be really, really welcomed. And I know that there'll be a commissioning officer for every, I suppose, service level agreement that's provided to the charity. So I think having that open dialogue and having that well recorded, I think, would be really, really helpful. If that's not already happening, but making sure that continues to happen well, because evidently if there's unmet need, there's somebody out there that's not getting the provision and support and help that's needed.
And I suppose the follow-on question to this, and you know, I was kind of trying to set the scene, you know, we're interested to know about the sort of how the sector feels in terms of its relationship. You know, do you feel that you're an equal partner, or do you think it's you know, there's partnership and then there's true partnership. Some are perhaps better than others. But also, is there still a sense in the sector that it's often looked at as the cheaper alternative, essentially, to public services? Therefore, we'll take... You take what it gets, essentially, which can be... I think people feel that, certainly, is what we've heard.
I think there's an element of honesty in that, certainly. I think things... Certainly, I think within Shetland, things are definitely UK, a lot more partnership, a lot more collaborative. I think King COVID certainly helped with that bringing together UK, and that really helped enable us to kind of join forces and actually just help and support where we could. So definitely there was really good examples of things going forward and working really well, and maybe working in that smaller rural community, you can, that helps to embed some of that. But I think there is still challenges in terms of budgetary stuff. And I know certainly UK, there's pay differences between public sector and charity sector, but people love working in the charity sector, and it's not essentially all about the salary. I suppose from some examples where if you do have really, really great staff that love the charity sector and love the work and the freedom and the ability to work in this sector, but in essence doing something really similar, you can in public sector, you can, we have that challenge of retaining staff when you can, the opportunity to do something similar is within a local authority area. So,
thanks. I wonder if I can just bring Ran in just to give the urban context to that, because I think Shetland, you know, that's a really helpful example of where things are working well and where the challenges are. But Ran, do you see some of this in terms of the context in Edinburgh?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and like Lynn and yourself touched upon the main bits there. One is, for me, my experiences from a day job and also as a trustee of Evoque, talking to a lot of, you know, organizations here and the statutory sector, I guess the communication and the structures are perhaps a bit more kind of like robust maybe than rural areas, but I still feel it's work in progress. A lot of the stuff, you know, is work in progress. During COVID, like what Lynn said, things were, well, in our opinion, from the third sector and the interface point of opinion, things were much more open and the conversations were much more flexible. Whereas post-COVID, it's gone back to a bit more systemic and structured bits, you know, like, for example, monitoring and evaluation and things like that, paperwork. And that's where I think if that's what it is post-COVID scenario, we need to make sure the governance and infrastructure support to third sector organizations, jointly perhaps given by the interface and offices and statutory sector, is looked at again and, you know, made much more unified. And this is why I'm talking about unified, Paul, all the time, is I think in pockets it works great, you know, the conversation with the statutory sector partners, funders and interface organizations and third sector. But it's not across the city, not across all sectors. And that's where this, you know, kind of like conversations about more fairness, more kind of like transparency, not having the infrastructure comes in. I think the models are all there. The conversations have already happened, you know, and services are already happening. Excellent services, innovative services. It's just tying them together. You know, how can we best do that? And I think that's a governance and infrastructure issue rather than, you know, reinventing the whole wheel of service delivery and procurement and allocation, you know, and evaluation, if that makes sense.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And lastly, I'm going to invite Kevin Stewart in.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to you. We've covered a lot of ground today. Multi-year funding, flexible funding, inflation adjustments, the real living wage, and the list goes on. But we have seen over a number of years the austerity agenda continue. The Chancellor will get to her feet on the 30th of October to deliver her first budget. What would your message be to her? Can we go to Lynn first, please?
I think it's about continuing to really value what the charity sector does, about supporting people in the community, supporting the grassroots, and really looking at investing in this area to ensure that paying charities are in the best possible position for early intervention and ensuring that support is provided to people in the community to live well for as long as possible. So it's about making sure that we're in that budget and we're in, that they invest well in our services going forward.
Okay, and should that include a multi-year spending review rather than just an annual budget as we've seen far too often of late?
Yes, that would be fabulous.
Thank you, Lynn. Can we go to Rand, please?
Yeah, Kevin, I completely agree with Lynn on that, like the multi-year kind of review. In addition to the annual budget review, it's absolutely important. But going back, if the message or if the strategy from the government and the local authorities and across the country is about prevention and early intervention, then we have to understand the people's journey is important. So that's like going back to the end user. And that's my conversation, or that would be my plea to the Chancellor, that think about what the person in the community wants and how important charity sector is to coordinate and help with that work. You know, that would be my message.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. And I want to thank you all for your evidence today. I now suspend this meeting to allow for the set-up of the next panel. Welcome back. We're now going to hear from a second panel, and I welcome Alan Folds, Senior Policy Officer from Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, known as the Alliance. Rachel Cackett, Chief Executive Officer, Coalition of Care Support Providers. Ewan Leach, Chief Executive of SURF, known as Scotland's Regeneration Forum, and Dr. Judith Turbine, Chief Executive of Children in Scotland. So thank you all for joining us today. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. If you could please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So I'm now going to invite the members in to ask their relevant questions, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in first. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to you all. I'm going to start with funding and multi-year funding. And I suppose just from your experience from your different organisations, what is the benefit of multi-year funding? Or are there any disadvantages to multi-year funding? And obviously you probably want it for 100 years, but realistically, what timescale are we looking at in regard to multi-year funding? Is it, you know, 2 year, 3 year, 5 year? What from your experience would work best, if possible? I think we might just work our way down, if that's okay. So we'll just start with you, Judith, and work our way down the line, if that's all right.
Great. Good morning, everybody. Lovely to be here. A very good question. I think there's quite a good answer to that, which is what tends to happen if you don't have multi-year funding is you're scrabbling around trying to put things together every year, and you can't really do that job of really strategically looking into the future. Well, you try to do it, but that's almost stymied by the fact that you're on this one-year cycle. It means that you sometimes use resources badly or not as well. No, you don't optimise your use of resources, because you might think, well, we better spend that this year because, quite frankly, we don't know what's happening next year. You might not take the right strategic decision. Let's actually invest in that in year two. Let's do it. So it makes, I think, the work less strategic. At least a lot of uncertainty, so it would give much more certainty to an organisation. And I think with any multi-year funding, there would have to be break clauses, there have to be reasons why the funding might stop. So, it's not 100% certainty, but it allows you to go to your board, to have that discussion with your board, to reassure your staff, not to be at the stage in December many years thinking, do I have to put out redundancy notices or not? You know, that stuff is all very unsettling, and it means, I think, it takes the attention away from the work and from what you're meant to be doing, which is supporting the end user, whoever that may be, whatever service it is you're offering. So I think it's really about that bit of using money well. And I think what the benefit would be for us is that strategic look, but also there's a real sort of opportunity cost to one-year funding, where the work doesn't only sit with the people who's receiving the money and having to report on a yearly basis and having to maybe do proposals on a yearly basis and business plans on a yearly basis, but the people who are having to service that are also having to spend a lot of time servicing that. So I think it makes things very efficient over time. And I think the thing, what it does, if you're going to have good multi-year funding, it does make you want to look at how you develop these funding relationships. So it's about trust and how you build those relationships. So it does need some changing, not that we don't have relationships of trust, but it does need a different way of monitoring and interacting. And so there's some work involved in that. In terms of the number of years, I think, as you say, how many years is good years? People talk about 3 years. 3 years is actually quite short if you're delivering a long-term service, but it's a lot better than one. I think 5 is quite a good interim measure. You know, in some ways, when you're thinking about some of the stuff, if you're investing in a new service, 5 to 10 years is when you would hope to really see the impact, and that means you would want to have a bit longer. But I think you can't expect, it's difficult to put to commit to that length of time, but I think we could get to a stage where 3 to 5 years would be a good way of looking at it with, as I say, if you're developing those relationships of trust and good monitoring and instruments based on that, then you've got to be able to have that conversation if things are not working, what you're doing with that funding. So it's not that you can never, you know, readjust that funding arrangement, but I think that would, that I'll stop there.
So. Could you answer me? I think the convener was going to tell me off very quickly. So it's very important we get it on the record, but if we can keep on just slightly briefer, or I'll get told off by the convener when you all leave the room. So, Ewan.
5-year funding would be preferable. The government already gives 3-year funding. There's multi-year funding through directly by government through the Investing Communities Fund and through through Creative Scotland and through Historic Environment Scotland. So they've regularly given 3-year funding deals. They all have caveats depending on an annual spending review. And until this year, I've never been aware of anyone losing funding during a 3-year period. This year, through the Investing Communities Fund, something different has happened. Which has been quite destabilising. It's maybe been rectified, and that's the second year of funding in a 3-year programme. A 3-year, I have previously been involved or received 3-year funding models. It is too short. You have the first year where not a lot happens, the second year things are happening, and the third year it's good, but it's beginning to decline. So 5-year to me should be kind of the minimum that you're looking for with 5 to 10, for all the reasons that Judith has said.
I mean, certainly our experience has not been of multi-year funding beyond 2 years. We've had a couple of 2-year grants, but I guess I'd like to talk more about our membership, our 90 charitable members who provide social care. And one of the things I would say is that social care is based on a relational approach, which is very hard to maintain in terms of the relationship between frontline staff and service users in a very unstable and uncertain funding arrangement. I am aware in some areas of Scotland they're beginning to look at much longer framework agreements for multiple collaborative approaches of up to 10 years, and of course that's great. It's really important that new entrants to the sector have an opportunity to come in and join those types of frameworks so that we're not sewing everything up, because obviously many community organisations are grassroots and built from the grassroots, so the diversity of provision remains incredibly important. You asked about risks, and I know that one of the risks for us of multi-year deals is that inflationary uplifts, at the very least, may not be passed on. So one of the issues that we've been dealing with this year, whether that's on annual funding or on multi-year funding, is the government has put out a letter around pay. Now, I can tell you that that's not enough, but at least there is an uplift around pay. That's often then causing issues with non-workforce costs. And I'll give you one example. Scotland Excel, which is the national agency for procurement, is responsible for the care and support framework. That was due to have begun anew in April. Because of various delays at Scotland Excel's end around governance, that has not been concluded and is unlikely to be concluded until the end of this month. Whilst the pay uplift has been awarded to everybody on that framework, all non-workforce uplifts have not, and nor will they be backdated, even though it was not the fault of providers that framework has been delayed. So that means that individual organisations are now trying to manage all non-workforce uplifts for the first 6 months of this year, with nothing of that replicated in the new framework when it comes in. Though that's one example of many I could give, where even where there are multi-year frameworks, particularly around non-workforce costs, there are massive pressures on the sector that we are being asked to pick up.
So I think I won't repeat many of the points that Judith have made around, you know, long-term planning, strategy and so on. I think the point about time taken with applications and seeking funding is quite important, particularly for smaller organisations. If you're a larger organisation, it's still not great if you're spending so much time looking for new funding. But a lot of smaller organisations, those people are actually doing on-the-ground service delivery. If you're a volunteer-led organisation, that's taken away from the volunteer time. So multi-year funding means less time spent doing that kind of admin work. Also, as the point about better relationships is quite important,
there can be quite a damaging relationship if you're having funding constantly sort of chopped and changed. Disadvantages, Rachel touched on one of the points I was going to make, which was about inflationary uplifts. It's not any good if you've got a multi-year deal, but it's the same money every year. It needs to have those uplifts built in. And I'm also aware that points have been made, and I know they were made at the workshop in Dundee the other week, about if you're doing sort of a three-year tranche of funding and you do all your funding at that point, if organisations don't get funding in that, then that's the potential that there are 3 years where those organisations aren't, like, they have no prospect of funding, or they're having to seek alternate sources. And I suppose one of the solutions there is, instead of doing all of that money in 3 years, you do it on a rolling basis. You do some of the money 1 year, and then the next year some, and then so on. So it's, there is at least that sort of rolling opportunity, and also if any new organisations emerge in that time. And then just on timescales, yeah, I mean, I think 3 years is a lot better than we have right now, and I think everyone would agree that we'd be happy with 3 years. 5 years, you could argue, would align with, for example, if you're talking about five-year funding deals from the government, that might align to parliamentary terms and so on, but we then come back to that point about staggering. But to be honest, anything more than the current 1 year that a lot of organisations are getting would be a significant improvement.
Just briefly, just following up on that quickly, obviously the money is important, but is there a perception level as well for the third sector that government funds public bodies, public services, guarantee them funding for indefinite periods? So, you know, if you're a doctor, if you work in the parliament, you know you're going to get paid next year and have a job next year. That's not true for the third sector. Does that, do you think, affect recruitment because people don't want that lack of stability?
I definitely think so. I think that one of the problems that we were very aware of is that lack of stability for jobs, the lack of ability to guarantee that you'll give inflationary pay uplifts, the fact that we know that a lot of equivalent roles in the third sector are paid at a lower rate than similar roles in other sectors is obviously we've heard directly from some members that draws people away who've been trained up at the cost of the third sector, and they end up moving to another sector, taking those skills with them. There's also a thing where, and I would say, you know, that obviously it's not the case that public services definitely have guaranteed funding from the government, because obviously we know the budgetary situation is tight, but we do have things like, for example, a guarantee of no compulsory redundancies within the public sector, which is obviously very good. We'd want to see compulsory redundancies amongst the public sector. But what you then find is that if there are cuts that are then coming down the line to the third sector, public sector funders aren't applying the same thing to the third sector. So we've had it described in some cases effectively that the compulsory redundancies are just shifted from the public sector to the third sector. And one of the points the Alliance has made, particularly around when it was coming up to renew the Finance Secretary's statement on sort of in-year budget shifts, was that we wrote and said that we would like to have seen a commitment to ensure that there were no compulsory redundancies within the third sector as a result of those decisions, on the same basis that a guarantee is given in the public sector.
Now, going to invite Bob Doddison. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, everyone. I know lots of the things we're seeing here is kind of well-trained ground. We've heard it all before. We talk about flexible funding. So, again, at the committee's away, Alan, and we heard a variety of things. We heard, irrespective of the quantum of cash available, more towards core costs would be helpful. A small slither of whatever funding towards reserves would be helpful. Unrestricted funds would be helpful. More flexibility in how funds are used more generally in terms of, like, you know, doing something differently to meet the outcomes in a different way as you learn from experience would be helpful. Lots of examples of more flexible funding. Judith, I'm going to come to you first. So brief reflections on those would be helpful. Maybe if there's something I haven't mentioned or something you want to particularly say would be welcome, please put it on the record. But also, would the best way of getting funders in that position to be co-producing the criteria that is used for those funds in the first place? So any comments about where there's examples of where funders have met with the third sector to discuss, well, here's what the criteria for funds may look like and how we can build flexibility at source as we design that fund. So, Judith, do you want to go first?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose I'll just very briefly talk about the experience of it, very briefly. The SIPV and ALEC, CIPFAL funding, and there's been, you'll have seen from the submissions, there's been challenges with that fund, but the nature of the fund and the way it was designed was very much based on a lot of conversations with the sector around it being core funding, it being around your own strategic plan, it being around, you know, you're reporting on your outcomes, you're not reporting on the activities that you're doing with that fund. And as we were coming to new phases of that funding, there was very good conversations around that. Unfortunately, the new funding wasn't launched. But I think it's a case of really understanding, not doing engagement exercises that, you know, are too immense and don't work, but really bringing people together to go and say what is working, what's not working, and the knowledge is there, and having that conversation at very early days before you start to think about how you design the fund, what would really work for the sector. And actually, the things that you've talked about are the things that you would take into account anyway. So it's like, in a way, you're just sort of building slightly upon that and then making sure that these voices are listened to. And it's, I suppose the challenge there is just not always just only the usual voices, but some others. But there is good, I think there are good examples of pieces of work where it's been co-produced. And I would say that fund, and I could go on about the disadvantages at length, but it is a good example of where what came out was a good example of what funding could look like. It wasn't multi-year, it wasn't blah, 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 but you know, yeah.
Thanks, Judith. Commendably concise. I appreciate that.
SERF's interests are, so our membership is from local authorities to housing associations to grassroots to volunteer groups to individuals. So it's a big cross-section of organisations. And we did some research with them last year on capital versus revenue spend. And what came out of that, there are huge sums that come, so I suppose in this Parliament, I think there was about £350 million allocated for a place-based investment fund. So the recipients of the Regeneration of Capital Grant Fund, the Vacant Derelict Land Fund, for large-scale physical projects, which happen and they're grateful for. So you've got a bit of community bling, but then actually running the project, all of them, the response is, well, we've got this nice thing, but we don't have enough money to deliver the services to the standard that we've maybe built something new. So there's and all the respondents to that, it was research done by University of Edinburgh postgrad, where there needs to be a rebalancing around that. Capital projects we know are expensive, and in communities you can sometimes see a lot of money being spent, and you can see it in Govan, where we are based. Everyone's looking at the bridge, 29 million, fantastic. But at the same time, people are thinking, where could 29 million go actually in our daily lives? The bridge will be transformational, but actually now, what are we needing for the community? So there's an issue around that balance of spend. In terms of criteria, there are groups of funders that meet and talk to each other, not always with the government, so independent funders or lottery or the NDPBs, and they discuss how to improve their grant-making process and continually refine it. If you get money from any government department, it's wildly varied as to how those decisions apparently are made and the processes. So anything, so looking at the SEVO's recommendations for what should happen, yes, multi-year funding, etc. But there's a whole bunch of stuff that could happen that wouldn't be happening at any cost. It would just require different activity and behaviour from within, across government, so that there's some kind of consistency in the grant-making process and that there's some transparency around that, both between departments within the government and for external organisations to look at how things are being funded.
That's very helpful. Rachel Cack.
Thank you. I mean, in social care and support, there is a lot of language at the moment around ethical and outcomes-based commissioning. And obviously, the proposals for a national care service are meant to embed those recommendations from Derek Feely. I mean, in a slightly more depressing note, I guess I'd say there's not as much evidence of that being enacted either at national or at local level within social care as one might expect from the language being used or one might hope from the aspiration, and remembering as well that Feely's now nearly 5 years old as a document. So I think in order to get to that point, we need to do a few things. First of all, is we need to challenge this idea that the third sector there is a sort of transactional recipients of cash. We are actually here in the social care sector providing a significant proportion of delivery in which taxpayers' money through public funds are being distributed through a system that includes the third sector. And I do think we, at our peril, continued to see third sector provision as just a transactional arrangement which then has to be so closely managed that, you know, we have armies of people having to service grants. And one of the things that my members have said to me was that through COVID there was a great deal more trust in the ability of those third sector providers to do what they do well, and with the people that they know so closely, that they work with every single day in social care. And one of the issues I think we have in this flexibility is how much flexibility there is at the front line to be able to adjust provision for people's needs. And quite often that can get caught up in red tape, and it can mean that sometimes that funding is not flowing in the way it should. So, for example, if you had even an annualised budget around individuals that could be adjusted at the front line in relationship and contact between the people providing the service and the person who knows what they need, then actually you would have much more flexibility to meet people's needs more effectively. So sometimes I think just the inefficiency of the way we handle public money flowing into public service, which includes third sector provision, and the way in which then that allows people to be flexible, the people who really know what needs to be done, not people who are five or six steps away, but the people at the front line in the relationship for social care, really matters. And I think we could do that so much better, multi-year funding or not.
Thank you, Rachel. Alan Foltz.
Yeah, so I suppose just in the kind of like putting on the record kind of thing, just a brief point about sort of flexibility. And I think that one of the things at the moment is that you can often have quite rigid splits between core and project funding. So you might have, you know, just to make up some numbers and spot, you might have for projects, you know, 1.6 full-time equivalent, you've got another that's 4 full-time equivalent staff, and then you've got your core. And you might find that actually, because a lot of these things are interlinked, that there might be relations between those different projects. Because you've got those strict splits between pots of cash, it can be difficult to sort of link those projects together. And also, if your, you know, projects do end, that is a thing that happens. If you have more flexible arrangements, you can better plan for sort of transitions for staff. So you might have staff who've been working on a particular project. They've developed connections, skills, resources that might be useful to keep in your organisation. But if they are just tied to that one project, you might then just have to let them go at the end of that project. Where you've got a bit more flexibility to use your core funding, you might be able to find ways to redeploy them. So just be more flexible at how money can be used to support different projects and staff, rather than being really specific that we have funded X amount for X project and you can't spend more nor less than that on it.
That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay. Before I bring in Ross McCall, I'm going to invite Kevin Shute in. Thank you.
Convener, I've got a devil's advocate question, basically. Which is for Ewan, around about the commentary that he made about the different forms of application within government itself, and then how the cake is split. So let's take some examples which Ewan would be aware of. If we look at capital regeneration funding, obviously, the government is in agreement with COSLA that they have a major part to play in terms of the allocation of funding. If we look at some of the scenarios that have come about of late in terms of some funding for health and social care for addiction, you know, CORA Foundation do a huge amount of the legwork there. So there are these scenarios where government has agreed that others become involved in processes. So I take it that you're not arguing for universality of decision-making. Maybe you are, I don't know. How do you think that that could be streamlined? Or is it the case that we just need to communicate better how these things are done?
So I'm talking about consistency within government directorates as to how they... So yes, there are some external... So some money goes to external organisations who... And I'm not asking for government... I'm not asking for centralisation. But some consistency across funders. And so during COVID, it happened. The funders began behaving differently and began giving out money with being much more flexible. But there also became a kind of much more, a simpler process in accessing those funds. And so, but within government, within various, because organisations will invariably get different money from different departments, from different directorates, and they're not all approaching it in the same way. So in terms of the process and how much information you have to give. So it's providing, and it's one organisation having to go to those different directorates for different reasons. I mean, I would also come back on the fact that when we're looking at creating new funds, this sounds like heretical to say, but you know, we suddenly introduced a lot of money around climate change, which is very important. But we ended up setting up a whole bunch of new organisations to deliver climate change issues when there was already a bunch of organisations who were delivering things that were related to climate change, but not with climate change in their name. And so we've created another layer that requires governance and management when there are established organisations and anchor organisations that they could have been asked to help deliver a project that ties into their general work anyway, and the money would have gone a bit further. And I don't want to take away, I'm not now saying we should take away money from climate-focused organisations, but it was an example of it seemed new, so we'll do something new. So introducing new funds and creating new organisations in an already over-competitive third sector and requiring more competition doesn't necessarily result in a really healthy ecology of organisations delivering change on the ground for communities.
Badging of something new often creates, you think, an additional scenario where a bureaucracy grows and other people come into play. I think that's a good steer there. I wonder, because you said within directorates, I'm going to turn to Rachel, which is a kind of mental wellbeing and social care aspect. If you look at funding for the Adult Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund, which is distributed by TSIs, which is different from how we funded the children's equivalent, which was done through local authorities. Do you think that's confusing for the third sector? Do you think that they would kind of like some uniformity and things like that, for example?
I mean, I guess it depends what you mean by uniformity. I totally agree with you in terms of government directorates, and we deal with a number of them.
One directorate there, basically.
But no, we do deal beyond that because we also have funding through justice and other areas as well. So actually, there are very significant differences between the way not only we apply, but also the way in which we're monitored. And I think within the main directorate, which is the Adult Social Care Directorate that we deal with, there have been moves this year to try to streamline that for us because the administrative burden on us as an organisation, sure, a very small organisation, is quite high, and there have been definite moves towards that. But I do think there is a really complex funding landscape for people who are working in the sector, remembering that many social care organisations will work across age ranges, they'll work across particular needs, which may include mental health. And so actually the burden ends up being on the recipients of funding to try to negotiate quite a complex system. I was in a meeting with housing support providers this week when they were talking in housing just about how many different sources of funding they have. And sometimes that means, for example, that some homelessness or housing services are included within the adult social care pay uplift and some are not, because there are constant lines being drawn in the way in which budgets are being handled, rather than actually taking a view that there are people in society who need support to need a good life, and therefore there is funding available to support that from the public sector through public service. So actually what funders are having to do is constantly work out the lines and jump through the hoops with very different ideas for how both funding is distributed, who it's distributed by, and what monitoring there is of that funding. Some simple streamlining of that could make such an efficiency difference as well within organisations when third sector organisations are really incredibly stretched right now.
Thank you, Convener. I could probably go on at length about things like the National Care Service in terms of some of this, but I will forgo that. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCullen.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Thank you very much. I'm going to pinpoint down on the inflation uplift point, if that's okay. And I'll come to you first, Rachel, since you mentioned it. So we've talked about multi-year funding and we've spoken about flexible funding. And there's always going to be this sort of rubbing dichotomy against the fact that there's going to be fixed costs that have to be taken into consideration. And that's a standard point. And if you put that into multi-year funding, the inflationary uplift becomes part of an issue. So can you give me a little bit more information on what you mean by inflationary uplifts, how you think that's going to, and how can we do it? Rachel, big question.
Big question. Okay, and I'll try and keep it concise. I think before we even start to talk about inflationary uplifts in the sector, which I represent in social care, we have to remember that there has been comparative to other parts of the public sector, a relatively low amount of investment in the sector. So even if we're starting to talk about inflationary uplifts, we're not necessarily starting from a benchmark that starts with the true cost of care. You only have to look at some of the negotiations around things like the care home contract to see just how far very often we are from actually delivering the true cost of care. And Mr. Stewart was mentioning the National Care Service. You know, one of the things that's not in the bill at the moment, for example, is any mechanism within the bill to assess what is the cost of actually providing care and support to the Scottish public in the way that we would want to. Which is not to say I think there's a magic money tree that will then actually be able to fill that gap, but at least we would be able to manage the risk between available funds and actual need. And that's not even taking into account unmet need, of which there is much. So let's start with the fact that we probably, even if we started to add inflationary uplifts to what we got, it's not enough because we're not actually funding the true cost of delivering care at this point in time. We're in a situation at the moment in social care where the Scottish Government sets the uplift for, it was just adults, now children's social care, though I would note that the letter for children's social care uplifts have only gone out, are only going out now, 6 months into the year, so children's providers have been trying to manage that gap. And therefore there is an inflationary uplift, and I make the same point, the benchmark is very low, but there is an inflationary uplift, so, you know, we're told there's been a 14.9% rise in 2 years, but it's 14.9% or not enough. So we have a situation where the inflationary uplift or the uplift for staff wages is still causing a 20% turnover, more than 20% turnover in our sector. Once you take those out of the way, you've also got a formula at the moment that doesn't allow third sector organisations to then maintain differentials. So management jobs have become incredibly unpopular to take because the amount of money that's left to then add a differential in a pay uplift to managers is very small. So for the huge amount of responsibility a social care manager is being asked to undertake, there's not enough of a pay differential to make that attractive. So even within wages, we don't have enough. But then you're looking at running costs. If you're running a residential space, you've got all the usual things. But even if you're just running an organisation with a head office that you need to do all of this, you've got all of your fuel costs, you know, everything else that goes around that. And because the letter from the Scottish Government is limited only to a particular way of applying a pay uplift, it's then left to local negotiations or on national frameworks with Scotland Excel to negotiate everything else. And what we've seen this year is that those negotiations are being depressed. So the additional costs are being held by charities. And actually, I had a meeting with my members on Monday, which was probably the most depressing meeting I've had with my members in over 2 years. Not, you know, we had the announcements last week centrally. But I'm hearing of members going into pretty aggressive conversations now at a local level with cuts mid-year being made, and that includes real pressure on non-workforce costs, which is the one thing that has a level of protection around it.
They accept, and I understand the position that you're in, and I'm sorry to sort of force this issue, but what I'm trying to do, Kat, because we need to know what you advise on how we can do this, and I know that's the big question on how we can look at this, because if there's a straight, simple sum of saying, yeah, we just give inflationary rises, there has to be fixed costs. You have to assume if you're doing multi-level funding that those are fixed and they're going to be fixed for the term. 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, they're going to be fixed. So you're talking about just putting an inflationary rise on top of everything? Or what are you asking for?
I guess what I'm asking for is...
Remind everyone to try and make their questions and answers as concise as possible, please.
I think where it can work at its best is where there is, frankly, a grown-up discussion between those who hold the purse strings and those who are actually delivering the service. Mm-hmm. And it has to be done on a genuine discussion about the true cost of delivery. Yes. So despite what I said about Scotland Excel earlier and the slowness of the process, nevertheless, at the early part of that, there were discussions with providers to actually help them to estimate and to work with them to estimate the true cost of delivering that care. Now, yes, of course, there's going to be negotiation over that. But actually, it's not just about fixing a number and then sticking to it. It's actually about being flexible through the process and trusting that providers, you know, providers are not there to make money. Providers are there to deliver a service that is affordable. And that comes down to a genuine conversation between commissioners and providers. And too often at the moment, that is under extreme pressure. And the main focus at the moment is pushing costs down.
OK, I accept that. I don't think we've got time to ask anyone else, but What do we have?
Judith would like to come in.
One second, just to reflect back that when you're in that kind of relationship, you may be getting inflation uplifts if you're grant funded, you're not tending to get inflation uplifts and you haven't had them for years. So 40% decrease in the value of funds over the last 5 to 8 years. So there has been no inflationary uplift. And I agree with Rachel, it's quite easy to do if you have that trusting relationship and you can carry it.
Thank you for that. Thank you, Pam.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm going to stay on the kind of issue about the real living wage. I don't know how much you can give us back, obviously, but I wanted you to talk about the challenges that you or your partners could be currently experiencing in terms of, you know, meeting that commitment to paying the real wage, and what really more needs done to actually support organisations to sort of meet that game. Alan, I'll start with yourself. If you can be brief as well, just obviously in interest of time.
Yeah, no, the real living wage point is really important because for a lot of third sector organisations, it's a condition of the contract that you have to pay the real living wage, and I think that all organisations want to pay the real living wage. Mm. They want their staff to be well paid. So part of that is that if the government is attaching that condition, it needs to then provide the funding to ensure that the organisations can do that. It can't just attach that condition and then not provide the relevant funding. And of course, we know what the real living wage is each year. We know what that goes up to. So there's at least a sort of a baseline there for them to work from. But actually, just to pick up on Rachel's point, because I think that's quite useful, on the sort of effectively flattening of pay grades, that also needs to be taken into account because the third sector needs to remain sort of an attractive place for people to build a career. And you know, if people can't see a long-term career in this area, then we will lose them from the sector. We'll lose that talent and those skills. And you know, that's obviously not a circumstance that we want to be in. And I had another point, but as these things tend to happen, it's gone completely from my brain, so I'll finish there.
Rachel, sorry, I couldn't see this. Just shine
okay.
On your name there.
In 2019, the Fair Work and Social Care report came out, and there's been an aspiration to provide Fair Work and Social Care since. One of my concerns at the moment, the real living wage, which is a superb mechanism to actually genuinely look at the minima that we should be looking at in terms of people being able to live a decent life, is being equated with Fair Work in social care. And we have to remember that if you're a frontline social care worker, you are trained, you are regulated, which is very different from the equivalent workers in the NHS who are not. And you are doing really complex work, increasingly complex work as needs change. And actually, we are in a position at the moment, and it was announced, it wasn't announced actually, the First Minister didn't mention social care in the programme for government in his speech, but if you look at the document, it continues to link the baseline pay for a social care worker to the real living wage. And the real living wage is a great thing, but that's an inappropriate baseline for what we're asking social care staff to do. So yes, as has been said, grant conditions are to pay the real living wage, but that doesn't deal with the recruitment issue that we have. If you're paying your cleaner and your frontline worker the real living wage because that's what you're now funded to do for your frontline worker, you're certainly not recognising the qualifications and the regulatory professional regulation that work is actually expected to work within, and then you can't maintain the differentials because you can't pay people through the system enough. So I would really like to decouple the idea that delivering the real living wage is the same thing as delivering the 2019 Fair Work and Social Care recommendations.
Thank you. Anyone else?
From our perspective, I suppose that one of the things that came up most recently for us as an issue was actually with a government agency sponsor wanted us to apply real living wage to surf award applicants, and we had to draw their attention to the fact that some of these projects are completely volunteer based, and also there are areas that are experiencing deprivation and the wages aren't high. And so yes, we would love to be able to say that would be possible, but it's not possible because the funding isn't there to make that happen, as Rachel has just said. I suppose the second point that I would bring in, and I'm bringing it up now because it's not no one's mentioned it, but when some of the discussions are in real living wage, cost of living and power dynamics, pensions. Mm-hmm. No one's talked about, you know, so I know roughly what your pension contributions are as state employees, but you know ours might be about 3 or 6, 3 maybe 6%. It's tiny. The good news is it means that you'll retire rich and can then volunteer. But the people who work in the voluntary sector will not be retiring rich. So they will not be in a position, they will not be on significant pensions at that point. And that to me is, and that is also a cause for people leaving. I started my pension far too late in life, but I can see people younger than me, 10 to 15 years younger than me, who are making choices about not working in the voluntary sector because they are thinking, they are sensible and are thinking very long term. And so they're moving to organisations where the pension contributions are above 25%, still in the public sector. And nobody within the voluntary sector seems to be, so we were not taking that on because currently the salaries aren't good enough, but it is a very significant issue, I think, across, will continue to be a significant issue across the staff, even without the real living wage.
Do you want to add?
Just very quickly, I mean, we love the idea of the real living wage as an employer with Children Scotland. We do that. It's meant we've had to lose one of our pay rungs, and again, so therefore squishing together roles that, you know, might have been in different places before. But, you know, we sign up to that. But like Ewan was saying, that membership thing, it really puts a pressure on the membership of tiny organisations who have very little budget, and then if the grants or the money that they're getting doesn't reflect that and doesn't give inflationary uplifts and whatever, then it becomes more and more difficult to fulfil that real living wage commitment. So I think it does make things tricky.
Thank you.
Very committed to it, but tricky.
Yeah. Thank you. Not putting you in the spot, Alan, just giving you that opportunity if you want to come back in with...
I did recall the thought that I wanted to make was just a point that someone had made, I think, in previous evidence at a previous session, was just the point of some of the approach to pay that some organisations are now taking is fewer people paid better. And that obviously then has implications in terms of, you know, how many people are in work, for one thing, which is obviously important for the wider economy, but also has implications for those fewer individuals, you know, work, and you know how much work they are doing and how much pressure they're under, and then on how many people they're able to provide services to.
Thank you for that.
Okay, thanks very much. Before I invite Katie in, I just wanted to touch upon that, what you said, Ewan, about the pensions. So obviously you've got your real living wage. Has there any work been undertaken with the Living Wage Foundation in terms of they're now introducing a real living pension and real living hours? And has that posed any challenges as well?
It's not work that we've been involved in, so I can't really comment on that in any sort of informed way. So we are interested in the real living wage, but the pension side of things, no, that hasn't. I wouldn't say has arrived at the voluntary sector or third sector's door as something that we would be able to address significantly.
Okay, Rachel, would you like to come in on that?
Just to say that under the Fair Work and Social Care work streams that government lead, there is a terms and conditions group that's been looking at wider terms and conditions than pay. I mean, a couple of things to add. One was that there was a lot of work done through COVID looking at sick pay, maternity and paternity pay, which are not equal. And we have to remember that some social care is delivered in-house in the public sector through local government, and much of it is not. But there is no parity in terms of the way workers are treated in terms of both pay terms and conditions, and that certainly includes pensions. You know, the group that looked at the terms and conditions had money set aside in the budget last year, which then just disappeared. So around 50 million just was left, and actually none of the recommendations could be implemented. Certainly pensions is an area that I think is another significant disparity, and one that I appreciate would cost a great deal to equalise, but I think the cost, and this is where we come into how cost is then accounted for through the public purse, the cost of actually not giving a decent retirement to people who've given public service is also great, but we don't tally that in the same way, and obviously it's over many years, but again it comes back to departmental budgets, the cost of not actually allowing people to have a well-funded retirement is not necessarily borne by the people who would need to put the budget in at the beginning when you think about how government is split.
OK, thank you very much. Just briefly, Judith, before I bring Katie in. Thank you.
brought up sick pay, and I just think it's quite important to know that some of the contracts that come out on the grants from the Scottish Government say that they won't cover sick pay, and therefore the risk of sick pay of anybody who's paid for through that grant sits with the organisation, as does redundancy. So that sits outside, so that's got to come from money that exists within the organisation. So again, putting an extra stress on the organisation.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, Katie Clark.
Thank you. And my question is about funding applications and how funders could work with third sector organisations, particularly smaller organisations, to create more proportionate reporting and application processes. I don't know who would like to start.
Reply to that. It sort of refers back to what Ewan said before. I think there's some really good examples of how to construct a easy to use, intuitive process, mostly from the independent grant giving sector, where you create something that people can easily use, a little bit of support through the process. A bit of advice at the very beginning so people know what they're doing, and then taking that as something that can be then nuanced a bit. It's not that you put that in and then you're marked out of 10. If the work is good, there should be the possibility to talk about it. So I think there's good examples to draw on. It's not something that is really rocket science and difficult to do.
So the last panel said that more uniform processes would help. Would you agree with that?
You were right, go.
Well, yes. Yes, but mindful of what Mr. Stewart said, it's not that everything has to be identical, and particularly if you're looking at what is always referred to as the cocktail of funding that projects often need within the groups that we're working with, and all the cocktail is a problem. If there was some kind of coherence around what that looks like, I mean, I suppose it comes. I have a kind of inclination to say the same funders continually fund community-based projects, and it's a group of them. And actually, what they could say is, I was about to swear, let's scrap what we're doing. Let's go to a place and say, we've got this, collectively, we can give this sum of money to a place. I don't want to say it's a bit like the town money that's coming up through levelling up, but it's a bit like going to a place and say, here's a sum of money, how does the community want to spend this? When it comes to regeneration, I'm not suggesting this happens around social care. And so there's only one process that those funders are then, because they're all wanting the same thing, they're all wanting the same outcomes. Some of them might be, and they're all linked to the National Performance Framework, which frankly we can all sign up to because, you know, it's high level. But they're all wanting the same outcome for the community, but you're having to do a different process for each one. So some of the funders have behaved differently. Some of them have even, I would say, begun aligning decision-making dates so that when someone's made a decision, then the next organisation knows that decision's been made. So they're basically adding money to a project that's got is a goer. And that, to me, is a healthy, you could say it's conspiratorial, but it's a kind of healthy way of making sure that funds do arrive in the right place. One of the issues that we have, and your issue around, you know, preventing new entrants coming in, we don't have growing pots of money to fund the third sector, but we often look for new things to happen because everyone loves cutting a ribbon. But it's not always the right answer. Funding the organisations that we already have that are doing great work in the community and funding them more, the money will go further rather than that. There are cold spots, and so where we have identified cold spots where there is no community anchor and there's no community helping we're talking about communities that need support here, not, you know, people that just want something nicer in the nice place that they live, people that really need it. There needs to be some kind of adjustment around that.
Thank you. Wants to come in here?
Yeah, just on the point around sort of, you know, more sort of proportionate reporting, I think what Judith was saying was that effectively there do exist some quite good examples of what that looks like, and I suppose it's just a case of learning from that best practice. We don't need to reinvent the wheel, and especially when we're talking about smaller organisations, the capacity of them to engage in like a lengthy process of redevelopment might be quite limited. Also, just on the point of reporting, I think something that would help is just transparency. You know, what is the reporting actually for? Like, what is it doing? Because obviously the easy thing to say is, well, it's to show that the public money is being used in like like a, in an appropriate and effective way. But like, is that what the reporting is actually doing, or is it just gathering a lot of information that then sits with, you know, the civil servant who's responsible for that pot of cash, and then a different civil servant or different local government department holds the reporting from different organisations? Like, is it being used in a sort of, because it's a huge amount of data is being collected, is that being used in a sort of a coherent way to sort of guide policy? And just a bit of transparency around, well, what is this for, what's it being used for, might also help with that reporting, just to like make it clear why that's happening, and then perhaps also trim out, well, certain things might not be particularly useful and we can drop those.
Okay. I don't know if Rachel would like
just to... Very briefly, I mean, I think uniformity is the main focus. Would only work if the process was so utterly brilliant we could be happy with uniformity. I don't think that in and of itself should be the focus. I do think transparency, not just in reporting, but in the process for actually being able to get funds, is also important. And sometimes the diversity of ways in which we're expected to jump through hoops lacks a level of transparency. And above all, at the moment, timeliness. The timeliness of decision-making in the process. You know, I gave some examples earlier of providers who were still waiting in September to know where they should have been in April. As an organisation, we didn't know until we didn't have our complete funding until the end of April. I know many organisations were even in a more difficult position. As charities, you're trying to make that work. You know, you're either holding staff and holding a reserve to not make people redundant, or you risk losing all of your skills because you're actually having to make people redundant before you know, and then you find you've got the funding. The lack of available timing is crucial to whatever we do next. We're at the bottom of the food chain when it comes to the distribution of money. We know far too late. And it's inefficient, it's poor use of public funds, and it's certainly not fair work to hold staff to a position where they do not know if they've got a job or not, because the timing of decision making, whether that's national or local government, is too late, far too late.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Which brings us on nicely to the area question that Jeremy is going to come on to. So thank you. I'll invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thanks.
Yeah, if I can just come right back to that, Rachel, what's the solution? So we see the problem. How do we get around that issue?
So at the moment, and I understand that, you know, we can talk about how late Westminster are and then how late the budget is. Certainly the budget here feels like it ever gets a little bit later. I mean, I don't think it's as bad this year as last year, which was, what, the day before recess at Christmas? And I understand that then there has to be a decision and a flow through of money. But that was always the case. You know, Parliament always has to pass a budget by a certain date in February. My sense at the moment is that rather than having significant discussions in advance of the final decision, were increasingly the public sector with their hands on the money, if you like, are waiting until they know for sure, and then the discussions are happening too late. So we're not even getting to in principle places, you know, which might still be not the final letter, but at least you would know. So it used to be the case that before Christmas we would often have an in-principle position of knowing what the intent was, notwithstanding there was a parliamentary process still to follow. That has not been the case. It's getting later and later and later. So for my organisation, my board has to underwrite salaries for the first quarter of every year in order that I don't give redundancy notices out in January, because I don't want to lose my staff, and nor will my public funders, because that's our expertise. So I do think we need to stop operating in an almost crisis management mode in timing, so that the decisions and the in principles are not being made early enough for us to at least begin to plan. And I appreciate until Parliament has passed the budget, we cannot be certain, but we can have a level of certainty that we don't currently have.
So just for my information, in regard to the letters of in principle, mm-hmm. are we going back pre-COVID? When they were used to be, is this something that disappeared during the COVID times and hasn't come back, or is it more longer than that period of time?
It certainly got worse in the last year or two. I would say that the lateness of decisions, even some government departments, and again I'm talking about my organisation rather than our members, because we do receive government funding. I would say that even the year before, we had at least an in principle earlier, whereas this year I think we only had one out of all of our funds, and mostly we were waiting till well, the end of March was generous. I mean, the end of April was when we got final decisions on everything.
Okay.
I would agree. It's been ongoing. It feels worse now, but it has been ongoing, whether or not you get the in principle just before Christmas, which is nice to know because it means you and your staff know, and that's a bit of relief. This year for us it was April, but it has been, and I know from my predecessor that it's been inconsistent as to when you actually find that out, and it does introduce a high degree of instability for staff.
Okay, that's really helpful. Just one other issue.
Concise as possible.
As always, Convener. Just around the issue of Disclosure Scotland fees, as you'll be aware, the Scottish Government are consulting at the moment of whether that fee should now be paid by the individual or by the charity rather than by the Scottish Government. Just wondering what impact, if that did happen, would have on people volunteering or in regard to the organisation having to pick up that cost.
I think for some organisations it has a big impact. If you have a very low, if you have a very small budget, it's just another additional payment, and you want to, you know, it's the thing that you have to have in place in order to safeguard your work. So I think it would have an impact, and if it was possible to not push that back to either to the charity, I think that would be a good thing. But I don't know if other people have a.
I mean, I guess it comes back to the fair work point to me, that if you're delivering a public service with the public pound, and actually you've got fees being a burden, if you like, on individuals rather than being paid through the public purse if you're in the public sector, that's a problem. SSC fees would be another one. If you're going to have parity in delivering public service, when you're already paying people in the third sector less than you would be paying if you were doing a local government job doing an identical piece of work, then actually we need to look at the parity across all of the expectations on those individual staff members, or indeed on those organisations who may well try to put the money together to pay those fees.
Thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thanks very much. Before I invite Paul O'Keenan, I believe Kevin Stewart would like to come in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Very briefly, because you've touched upon award letters, letters of comfort, and the parliamentary processes around about budgeting, which often has a major impact in some of these. You probably heard me ask the last panel around about what the Chancellor should do as she gets to her feet on the 30th of October around about these issues. What do you think the Chancellor needs to do around about multi-year funding, around about fair pay, around about the issues that we've talked about today? And maybe we can start with Alan, please.
Yeah, I suppose just very briefly, getting that certainty around sort of multi-year budgeting, and I'm kind of aware that there is supposed to be a statement in spring coming up following that's about sort of a more multi-year approach to budgeting. I would hope that that will come forward. I hope that gives the Scottish Government more ability to plan its finances, and then I hope that that would then lead to the Scottish Government and to other public sector funders in Scotland being able to then provide that multi-year security to organisations. And I suppose just the general thing is, from what I think all third sector organisations would want to see from the budget is a commitment to the third sector to recognising the value of the sort of charitable and voluntary organisations across the UK, but also just a sort of investment in the services, in public services, to make sure that there is less of a need for the third sector to step in and support where there's effectively sort of public service failure to provide people the things they need.
Judith, please.
I would say, first of all, talk about your public services as the totality of public services of which the third sector is a part, and therefore your budget has to show how that's going to, you know, really support that. I would invest in prevention. You know, we're storing up problems for ourselves if we don't carry on working in prevention. And I would say that every pound invested in, maybe not every charity and every third sector organisation, but the majority, is money that's invested and is leverage for us getting money in other places so that we can offer the services and have a bigger impact on the ground. And I would say make it multi-year if you can now. Take that risk. Take that risk. Certainly make sure that you are saying that decisions are going to be timely and they're going to come out so that we don't have to be in that position by April.
Rachel, 3-year spending review, 5-year spending review,
a proper spending review, of course. And actually, of course, we would welcome a proper multi-year spending review, particularly in the current circumstances. But I guess I would add something to even the question, because whatever the Chancellor in Westminster stands up and says in October, the government in Scotland has still got its own decision making within whatever comes its way. And you know, I can't tell you how dispiriting it was last week to hear a programme for government speech which didn't even mention social care. That has had a huge impact on the members. So whatever comes to Scotland, I would say, great, but take the decision-making that you've got to invest properly in social care. And I would also say, you know, a parliamentary question was answered last December that third sector organisations would know by the end of March what their funding was. That was not the case. We didn't know what our funding was by the end of March. So I think there are, whatever the Chancellor says, and of course I hope we have multi-year proper spending reviews, I hope additional funding can be invested in the people of the United Kingdom, including in the budgets that are coming to Scotland, but I think Scotland still has to do some work in then what it does with whatever the Chancellor says, and I certainly hope social care gets more of a mention.
Ewan?
I agree with what's been said, and I would also say, both to the UK and well, all levels of government, stop asking us to do more with less.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, that's lovely. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Paul O'Kane in. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. And my questions will kind of try to draw together a lot of what we've been talking about this morning. And obviously, we've had a wide-ranging discussion, but particularly focused on finance, and that's right, in terms of funding. I suppose what I'm keen to understand is we've been talking about fair funding principles now for quite some time. We've been talking about the need for parity of esteem and respect within the sector for a long, long time. Ewan, in one of your answers, you mentioned some of the kind of other mechanisms that could be looked at to I suppose, embed that fairer funding principle, but it necessarily doesn't cost money. It's about how you change structures. So I wonder if you might want to just comment on what some of those things are and how we might actually move forward on some of those issues.
Well, I suppose it's picking up on what's been said. I suppose the timing of decisions, the transparency of decisions, a relative uniformity to the process of how you apply for a grant across the government. And the transparency issue, I think, is about the application process. And this might be uncomfortable for everyone that receives a grant from the Scottish Government, but publishing what those agreements are and publishing our reports. I sometimes have had a fear that the reports don't get read and that they just sit on a shelf. And that information is rich and it isn't being used elsewhere. No disrespect to my overworked civil servant contacts. But there is huge information there. And publishing that so that, and even in terms of when you're looking at projects that you might want to do in the future as an organisation, knowing what other organisations have been at task to specifically to deliver through government funding would be really helpful, so that you can see that you suspect there's a gap, but you now know there's a gap because there is you know what the outcomes that the government are expecting across a range of organisations that you maybe work around with. But these are all process things which can be changed even if we don't get multi-year funding, and they would help the dynamic within the sector of the processes while we still endure it not being nirvana, which we're not going to get to, but things can improve, and improving the process is the thing that can be done in the short term.
Anyone else want to comment on that broad point? Rachel?
So I think for our sector and for the members that I represent, I mean, we had a recommendation from the independent review Derek Feely produced during COVID to talk about, you know, an end to competition based on price. And yet here we are some time later still with the predominant experience of members being competition that's now on a massively depressed price and increasingly under pressure. So I think one of the things that we could do is a lot of what we've been talking about this morning is a much more trusting approach to public service delivery through the third sector. And there are already options and levers out there, particularly for local government, to look at different ways of actually flowing funding, public funding, into public service through the third sector that's not being taken. We too often just revert to type on being expected to compete. And if we're looking at a National Care Service bill, then we have to make sure that that actually changes not just the structures, but also the culture. around how money flows so that it stops being based on the lowest possible price and a suspicion that things are not being delivered into a trusting relationship in which the true cost of care is properly delivered.
Thank you. Was that kind of preempted my second question, which you may have heard earlier, around that parity of esteem and ensuring that it's not about, you know, voluntary sector will do something that is cheaper than the public sector, therefore, and I think Ewan's point that you made about doing more and more with less. I mean, we've heard from SCVO and others that, we've heard this morning from you, Rachel, that many organisations are at their kind of lowest ebb. So, you know, what else can be done, I think, to start to repair the relationship? Because I think whatever happens, there has to be a kind of reset moment, although I feel like we've had lots of different reset moments over the years. So is there one thing that could be done immediately that would start to really change the conversation and the approach? Judith, I'm looking at you.
Yeah, I think, yeah, it doesn't matter that a reset's been done before. I think it is important. And one of the good things to do would to be stand up and say, we've got some of this wrong. And we really are now committed to implementing, you know, fair funding. But it comes back to, I think, the one change that we can make. And you see, it's not that it doesn't exist at all, but it's that culture of trust and mutual respect and parity of esteem, which you get in bilateral relationships, you get in other places, but the system doesn't really offer that parity of esteem. So it's how we can start to rebuild that culture. So I think it's starting with that and going, you know, we are in this together, starting with the perspective that we are all part of delivering public services. We're not, you know, it's not the public sector over here and the third sector over here. It is a common thing that we are doing together. So therefore, how can we make this as good as we possibly can be? And I think it needs a little bit of honesty from the part of the government. I think it's very, it often happens when you're in a crisis moment that people begin to look in on themselves and try to control more the funds and try to control more the processes because they're panicking about, you know, what's going on. And I think I've seen that a bit in Scottish Government over the last couple of years. And actually, in a crisis, that's when you should lift your head up and go, actually, this isn't the right way to do it. What, how do we work together better? So that's all a bit airy-fairy. But to me, if we reset that culture of trust, we could make some big strides.
Can we wonder if Alan might be able to come in? And
if you want to come in, Alan, thank you.
Yeah, just very briefly, because a lot of points have been touched on already, just things we can do now would be to recognise the third sector as an equal partner in appropriate places. So Rachel's been talking a lot about the NCS, I think, would share our concerns that on, for example, the proposed NCS board, there wasn't specific representation for the third sector. So making sure that the third sector is recognised as an equal partner. And also that extends to recognising the third sector in sort of economic and tax strategy setting. And I have to say, there has been some positive movement on that front. The Alliance have been involved in, for example, some of the discussions around the tax strategy. And I think perhaps in the past it was kind of seen that, you know, the third sector, that wasn't, economy and taxation wasn't where the third sector fit in. But actually we are part of the economy and it's just formally including us in that area, and all aspects of government planning would be a way to sort of properly recognise our value.
Rachel?
So in our sector, I guess, the ultimate point of our sector is to be able to provide support to people who need it. And actually, we know we have a crisis within every community in Scotland. There is not enough money to do that in the way that we would want to. And I think if we could recoalesce around the fact that we're all in this, whoever is involved in commissioning or providing a service, to provide a service to people who need it. And therefore, the solution has to be with all of us. And it picks Judith's point up. At the moment, what would make a real difference is rather than those commissioning discussions and the reallocation of budget discussions being about how do we squeeze the last penny out of this, to we have not enough cash to do what we need for people who need support. How are we going to do this together? At the moment, we did work back in the winter of last year looking at the resilience of our sector. For those people who responded to the survey that we were putting out, in March of this year, 83% of the members who responded were carrying on delivering a public service despite a deficit budget. Mm-hmm. The problems that local government and national government face are no different than independent charitable organisations that I represent, who are having to dig into reserves and still work with deficits. The problem is, at the moment, the risk is just being pushed down eventually to the people who need support to try and manage the deficits We need to actually work together, and it's a tone of conversation as much as it is anything else. How do we solve the problem jointly, rather than how do we squeeze you for some money and ask you to do yet more for even less?
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you, that concludes our questions. So thank you very much to the four members of our panel and sharing your views with the committee today. I've found it very helpful indeed. So we will be holding a further evidence session in October. So it concludes our public business for today, and we'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda.